We've talked a little bit how form affects function, and how one of the questions we can ask about fossils is, what does the form of the fossil tell us about the behavior of that fossil? But in asking that question, what is a fossil, really one of the things we're most fundamentally concerned with is this question of, what is it? What is the species? What does that tell us about where this organism fits in the past? And if we look at these fossils as an example of this, what that question really indicates is, what are the differences between these two fossils, and how do I explain that difference? And the first step in explaining that difference is understanding where biological variation comes from. We have a whole series of ways of talking about organizing biological variation. Going back to the 18th century and even earlier, naturalists began to classify organisms based on the kind of variation that they possessed and how they differed from one another. These kinds of classificatory schemes are an attempt to capture biological variation and describe it in some terms. For example, we have a standard classification system that we use today that we've inherited from the 18th century. And it divides biological variation, variation basically within the living world, into a hierarchical system. From at the largest view, the kingdom, down into phylum, class, order, family, and then finally genus and species. Within this class, we'll primarily be concerned at the very bottom of that hierarchy, since we're only looking at a small stretch of the biological world, the humans and great apes. So we're interested primarily in those genus or genera and the species that they represent. But what these names indicate is some attempt to capture the reality of the structure of biological variation. Now, it's important to keep in mind that evolution is tremendously good at sorting variation. That's largely what evolution does. It creates and sorts and establishes patterns of variation. Now, that sorting, however, is not always a complete process. So whereas we might use a very strict and hierarchical classification category system such as that, it's not always going to be the case that biology perfectly matches that. So for example, if we look back at this specimen, our question is, where does the biological variation within this specimen come from? Why might these two specimens be different? So in other words, why are individuals different in the world that we live in? Why do they differ in terms of their biology? Why do they differ in terms of their phenotype? There are a few fundamental differences that we can extract out of fossils and that exhibit themselves in humans as well very readily. The first of these is simply age. We change throughout our lives. We're not born as a finished product. So age is one of the reasons fossils might vary from each other. In the case of these two specimens, for example, we could again look at the base of them and we can see that there's differences in actually which dentition they've erupted. In this case, they're not that different actually, as they're both actually in the process of erupting their third molars. This one perhaps maybe a little further along than the other one. But the fact that specimens differ in their age is one of the reasons they differ in the phenotype that they present. So age is a fundamental source of variation. Another, at least in sexually dimorphic organisms, is sex. Human males and females are different. They differ in their morphology, they differ in the pattern of growth that they display. So sexual variation is another important source of variation that we find all around us. So we can use these two as a basic starting point for this question. Within a given group, we might have female individuals, male individuals, and we might have individuals who are young and individuals who are old. This is normal variation. Now, even further down, at an even more microscopic level, we might look at two, for example, female individuals who are the same age. There's no difference in age, there's no difference in sex, and yet they're very unlikely to look the same. Even if they're identical twins, there's probably some differences between them. So individual variation, the variation that just exists fundamentally between us as individuals, is another important component of variation. Now, individual variation comes from those concepts that we've already talked about: phenotype, environment, and genotype. The fact is, all of us as individuals differ slightly in the genes and the genetic variation that we've inherited. That differing genotype, together with the fact that we also all independently develop in different environments, we're exposed to different childhoods, we're exposed to different foods, we do different activities. So our genotype expresses itself slightly differently in those different environments, so that our final phenotype is a product of those two things and differs normally from one individual to the next. I have two older brothers. They have probably very similar genotypes to me in the sense that we share the same parents. We grew up in the same household. We're not that different in age, and yet we look very different from one another. This is normal. Variation is the normal condition, evolution creates and shapes patterns of variation. So as a starting point for understanding why things might differ, we have to recognize that things differ, and that's natural. They differ because of age, they differ because of sex. Those are the fundamental beginning points of understanding where variation comes from. Now, moving further along, we might consider this sample that we've established already here. Again, we have males and females differing of age, and in this case, they might occupy the same population. And by population, we mean basically a group of people who regularly interact and presumably exchange genes. So this is a group of individuals that interact, they occupy the same physical place, occasionally they might have sex and produce children, and so we can consider them a population. Now, within a population, we have a lot of natural variation because everyone differs, and everyone differs along age, and everyone differs along sex. But we might have, then, other populations adjacent or dispersed from this that also have males and females of differing age, and that also have their own normal variation. And because these two populations are different populations, there might be some contact between them, or gene flow, but the fact that they're differing populations occupying different environments might mean that there's a slightly different overall pattern of variation. So some of the variation we observe might be because this population is different than this population. It occupies a different environment. It again has different kinds of genetic variants present within it. This is again something we know naturally. If you walk through an airport, it's a fun game to play to try and guess what population individuals are coming from, based on simply their appearance or their clothes or how they speak or the language that they use. So population level variation is another important source of variation. Now, one of the things to keep in mind about populations is that they represent not just a natural combination of individuals who regularly meet and exchange genes, but also they're dispersed across both geographic and temporal space. So these two populations might exist 5 miles away from each other or 5,000 miles away from each other. That geographic distance between them likely is going to tell us something about how related or similar those populations are, and therefore how different we might expect them to be. It's generally the case in humans that the further two populations apart, the more different they are. So population is telling us something about geographic dispersion away from each other. But populations also exist through time. Populations don't exist only in the moment, they extend across time, where one generation gives rise to the next generation, so forth and so on. So populations are also giving us an example of variation across time. So there's a temporal component to this as well. So again, if we consider our two specimens right here again, we might say, oh, they differ because they're different sex or they're different age, or they might differ because they're from two different populations, scattered across two different geographic regions or across temporal distances from one another. In the case of these two fossils, the one here on my right is actually from Kenya in East Africa, the one on my left is from Georgia in Western Asia. So these are geographically dispersed from each other, and that might be part of the reason they show different morphologies, is because they're parts of different populations coming from different times and places. So as we add up our components of variation so far, we have normal individual variation, the kind of variation all of us display, variation systematic between sexes, what we refer to as sexual dimorphism, variation associated with age as we develop throughout our lives. That kind of variation is very simple to assess usually in the fossil record, as we can tell more or less the age of individuals, at least up until adulthood. But all of these together go into forming the overall pattern of variation that we might expect from a species. The species represents not just these few populations, but every population that's contained within this species. Every population that might potentially reproduce and produce the next generation is ensconced within this larger category of the species. When we think of the fossil record, the species are oftentimes the fundamental unit that we're thinking of. When we ask that question of, what is this? Oftentimes what we're asking is, what name do we attach to it? What genus and species is this? Is this Homo habilis? Is it Homo erectus? Or is it some other name altogether? Now, as it turns out, species are a fundamental unit in biology, but they're also fundamentally challenging. The gold standard we use for establishing species or defining species is reproductive viability. This is a concept we get from Ernst Mayr in the 20th century, and we refer to it usually as the biological species concept, with the idea that a species is defined as individuals who can potentially reproduce and produce viable offspring. So there are individuals who can potentially reproduce subsequent generations. This fits in with our understanding of how evolution works very well. When we look across at the biological world, what we see are a lot of organisms that either can or cannot reproduce. And this fits in with, again, how we expect evolution to work. However, that category of species, that concept of species, the biological species concept, it turns out is challenging to apply in certain circumstances. Imagine, for example, we're comparing two very similar looking things, but that happen to be on the opposite sides of the planet. In that context, it would be hard to decide whether or not those two individuals could actually produce viable offspring given the opportunity. So in that concept, biological species concept is actually fairly narrowly defined, or at least narrowly applicable, given the fact that it's really talking about organisms that are adjacent to each other, or at least in contact in the real world. This becomes even more problematic when we move to the fossil record and think about fossils that might be separated not just by geographic distance, but by tens of thousands of years. Even if we think these things are fairly similar, and even if they were from the same environment, what if they're 10,000 or 100,000 years apart? How would we apply that notion of a biological species and the notion of reproductive viability? Of course, we can't directly. We have to instead make a few additional assumptions. One of the basic assumptions we make about species in the fossil record is that morphological variation corresponds to genetic differences. The more similar two specimens are in their morphology, we tend to think the more similar they are in their genetics, and therefore the more likely they are able to reproduce. In other words, the more likely they're the same species. Likewise, the more different they are, the more divergent we think they are, and perhaps the less likely they are to be able to reproduce. A translation of the biological species concept for the fossil record is sometimes referred to as the evolutionary species concept, which basically says we look at the morphology of fossils, and whenever we see an independent trajectory of a fossil, so we see a lineage that is evolving in a different direction from other lineages, that has a distinct starting point, a distinct trajectory, and a distinct ending point within the fossil record, and we can illustrate this on the board, we have what's referred to as an evolutionary species. So imagine we have some common ancestor evolving in the past. At some point along the way, we begin to get a divergence in terms of the morphology we're observing in the fossil record. And we eventually see two separate endpoints. One of these species maybe dies out. The other one goes on and gives rise to other species. So what we have here is a different trajectory and a different endpoint. Those are the criteria necessary to establish an evolutionary species. If this is what we observed, we might decide that this represents a unique evolutionary species from this right here, where that evolutionary species is defined by the trajectory of morphological change through time in the fossil record, and the fact that there's a distinct endpoint to that trajectory of change. So species, although they're a fundamental unit of biology, species are a real concept. Biology organizes itself, evolution organizes variation to fit into certain kinds of categorical components, and species are perhaps the most fundamental. The processes that occur within the species level, those kinds of variation that gives rise according to age and sex and populations, are fundamentally different than the processes that occur above the species level. The interaction between species, species competition, prey and predators, other kinds of host-parasite relationships are between species interactions. Within species concepts are different, so this species category is fundamental, and yet it's a challenge. One of the hardest challenges and one of the most debated and argued about topics within paleoanthropology are these names that we assign to the fossils. What genus and what species does this belong to? What's the appropriate category to place it into? And that concept has a lot to do with how we describe and understand biological variation. What epistemological approach do we take to try and ask that question, and how ultimately do we assign the variation that we see within any two specimens? Are these the same species? Are they different? How do we go about answering that question? What kind of variation might be associated with variation below the species level? Individual, age and sex, population? What kind of variation might be associated with these two, or what kind of variation might establish these two as different species? What signals might give us that these are not reproductively viable individuals, but rather different species altogether? This is a concept that we'll return to again and again within the fossil record. This again will be a big part of how we try and construct the evolutionary models that we develop. Do we have lots of human species over the last 2 million years or 5 million years? Or do we have only a few human species? Part of that has to do with how we categorize variation, how we understand variation. Variation is the normal condition. Evolution creates and shapes patterns of variation. We try and understand that variation. One of the ways we do is by assigning names, species, to fossils. So that's what we'll be doing a lot within 207X, trying to understand variation in fossils, trying to assign a specific cause or a reason why that variation exists. Is it because specimens are of a different age, different population, or is it because they're different species? And if so, what happens to those species over time as they evolve? What is their ultimate end fate? Where do they go? What happens to them?